Are you still opening ports on your router? Maybe setting up dynamic DNS to get into your server when you're not home? Today, I'm going to show you a much better option, and it's called Tailscale. It's based on WireGuard, it's dead simple to set up, and it'll let you connect your devices from anywhere in the world. No port forwarding, no complicated configs. Let's get stuck into it. Here's the problem with traditional methods. Port forwarding exposes your entire network to the internet. There are bots scanning constantly, as we covered in our video last week. And if you slip up with one outdated config, password, or any sort of service, you're in big trouble. What about dynamic DNS, you might ask? Well, it sort of works, but it's fragile. If your ISP changes your IP address, or your dynamic DNS provider hiccups, and suddenly you can't connect, what do you do then? What about old school VPNs? Yeah, they're pretty good. But they can be tricky to configure, maintain, and troubleshoot, especially if you're just starting out. Enter Tailscale. It's basically a mesh VPN that uses your identity provider, whether it's Google, Microsoft, GitHub, to authenticate. No servers to maintain, no complex firewall rules, no public exposure. What are some of the trade-offs? Well, we can use something like WireGuard, which obviously Tailscale is built in WireGuard, but it does give you some additional features that you won't get out of plain old WireGuard. Some of those being the Magic DNS feature, allowing you to use your DNS from your local network across anywhere in the world, as if you were sitting right at home, and a couple of other features that Tailscale really highlights and sits above the rest. Another trade-off to consider, and of course be transparent about, is that Tailscale is a private entity, a private company, whatever you want to call it. So you are having to put your trust into another business handling your data and connections. But I don't know about you, I'm definitely no expert with VPNs when it comes to building my own. I use WireGuard and I have used it many times without problems. And maybe perhaps WireGuard on its own is enough for what you need. But for everyone else, like ourselves, we really love Tailscale. We are not sponsored by Tailscale, nor are we affiliated with them whatsoever. I just really like the product. I like the service, and I've been using it for about 4 years now with zero problems and zero hiccups. They've never asked me for a cent, and I've been able to access both my networks at home and in our cloud servers without any problems, allowing me to troubleshoot problems quickly without opening up any ports whatsoever. All right, why don't we start and I'll show you, and you can tell me whether you find it easy enough. Let's go. Now, the first thing I'm going to do is go to tailscale.com. Go to the website and go ahead and create an account. In the top right, you'll see here, get started. It's completely free. You'll be given various different options. You can either sign up with any of these services. If you want to be able to use an email, that's the only time where they really ask you to create a paid plan. But in most cases, you'll have one of these accounts anyway, so just use one of them. We use GitHub for our sign-in authentication method, so there's nothing wrong with using GitHub if that works for you as well. Once you sign into GitHub, it's going to give you a prompt here to authorize Tailscale to use your account. Now, you can just provide the account. You do not need to grant access to organizations or anything like that. So just go ahead and click Authorize Tailscale. Now, when you first sign in, obviously you're not going to have any devices. Just to give you an example of what it looks like once we're done, you can see I've got my Unraid server here. I have another Ubuntu server running in our cloud environment here. And I also have my desktop that I'm using right now. And I have my phone listed in there as well. That means anywhere in the world, I can connect to the Tailscale network and I'll be able to access those devices. There are other things like subnets and exit nodes, which we'll cover shortly as well. But just to give you an idea, an exit node allows us to use that node for our internet connectivity. So if we're in another country and we can't access something, we can go via our server here, which is running as an exit node, and allow the connectivity to happen from that point outwards. So with that said, the first thing we want to do is obviously add a device. So in the top here, you can see you've got the option to add a device, whether it's a Linux server or a client device. Now, if you're on a mobile device, you'll be able to grab Tailscale from your app store, whether it's Google Play or the Apple store. Let's say we want to do a Linux server. Click on that. And what it's going to give us is a page where we can configure the install script right from the beginning. Now, we can add a tag if we wish. We can go to manage tags and access controls. And what this allows us to do is provide a little bit more authentication with our connectivity. So access controls allow us to then allow certain things or certain people to access particular resources. So you can see here, for example, Tailscale SSH, we've got groups, we've got tags, we've got IP sets, hosts. So if you have various people in a team, like we do at IBRACORP, we can provide certain people access to certain resources in our Tailscale account, rather than just giving flat out access to a VPN or something like WireGuard. That's something that separates Tailscale from other services, which is really, really cool. So right now it's currently got the default, which is that all users can access all devices and users and all ports and protocols. I'm the only one that uses it right now, so that works. But if you start adding people and you want to be able to share things out, for example, under the users section, we can actually invite them and have approvals in place so that we can control who accesses what, when, and how. So if we come back to the install page, we're not going to add any tags. We can say to automatically remove the device from our tailnet when it goes offline. So perhaps it's just a temporary thing we're trying to access and we don't want further access once it goes offline. Whether we want to use it as an exit node, as I explained earlier, it routes traffic through the device on our Tailscale network. We also have authentication key settings, whether it's reusable, we can tick that on or off, and whether it expires, how long that expiry takes place. So let's say 7 days in this case. Then we can just come down and click generate install script. Now it's going to give you the install script right here. Let's copy that and go over to our Linux server or Ubuntu server that you're running, whatever it might be, and we'll execute it. Now I use Termius as my favorite terminal client. That's what I use, allows me to access all my servers. Big shout out to Hawksy for showing me this one quite a while back. But anyway, we've go to our server and we've got a whole bunch of stuff running in there being containers. I already have a Tailscale LXC container, which allows access to this, you know, entire environment. But for today's video, I'm gonna show you how to do it anyway. So let's find a server that's currently online. And unironically, I'm actually connected to my Tailscale network to allow me to SSH into these servers. They are not open to the internet, so SSH is locked behind my Tailscale network. So here we are on the Ubuntu server. We can right click that script that we got earlier and hit enter. Now, if you're planning to use the IP forwarding part of Tailscale, which is a really helpful feature, allowing you to access resources on that local network, you'll need to enable forwarding on your server. The documentation here on Tailscale is pretty good. Basically, if it has this directory, use this command, it will enable that IP forwarding and allow Tailscale to act as basically a router. So then no matter where you are, you can type that local address in and access things remotely using the local IP of that network. Now, if you're on Unraid, thankfully in the latest versions of Unraid, Tailscale comes built into the OS now. So I'll show you how to do that now. Go into settings at the top, head over to Tailscale. If it's not installed, just go to the App Store and grab Tailscale, obviously. But what we don't want is the Docker container for Tailscale anymore. Now we're using the plugin for Tailscale. This allows us to continue to use the service even if our Docker service isn't running. That's the biggest leverage we get. Whereas if we're using the Docker container like we used to show at the time, which was the only one available at the time, that means that, you know, if the Docker container stopped and wasn't running or had an issue, we lost our remote access, which is not really what you want, especially when you're traveling, which seems to be the only time things tend to fall apart. So inside of the Tailscale settings, if we go to settings here, do we want to enable it? Obviously we say yes. Unraid services listen on the Tailscale IP, we're going to say yes as well. And do we want to enable that IP forwarding like I just mentioned on the Linux server on Unraid? The answer is yes as well. Now, if we want to use Taildrop, which allows us to share files across the tailnet, we can enable that location here and specify what it is. We also have the ability to add peers to our host file on the server. And as it says here, it's useful if you want to use Tailscale DNS names without the potential complications of enabling Tailscale DNS on the server. Now, personally, I've never had issues with Tailscale DNS, but if you are, this gives you that option as well. It's going to ask you for the port. In this case, it's 41641, which should be just the default unless you're already using that for some reason, or you're using it in conjunction with WireGuard. I wouldn't probably recommend using both at the same time though. Stick to one or the other. Then we have our advanced networking. Do we want subnets enabled and do we want the Tailscale DNS enabled? Currently they're set to no. I really don't know why, because I think I actually have them enabled anyway. So drop in the comments below if you get that one a little bit better than I do. Now, once you go through this, you'll need to obviously authenticate to Tailscale. So you'll be able to authenticate, make sure you do that. It'll take you through the Tailscale dashboard where you'll sign in, allow that device access to your tailnet, and then you'll come back here and continue. So that makes perfect sense. So if we enable this, it means it's only needed if our Unraid server needs to connect to remote subnets advertised by other devices, which in our case we don't need. It's already acting as our router for our local network here, so I'm just going to leave that as it is. And then we have options like SSH. Do we want to enable that over Tailnet? By default, security-wise, I would say leave it as disabled until you need it, then enable it. Do we want to run it as an exit node? I say yes, I enable that. And then do we want LAN access while using the exit node as well? I've currently got that set to yes. So I can access the LAN of the server when I'm using it as an exit node too. The next part you see here is the advertised routes. Now this part is what makes it pretty cool. So when I put in 192.168.1.0/24, it means I can access any devices on that network as long as obviously the server itself has access to that same network. If I have another network that I've got, let's say 10.0.11.1, you know, and so on and so forth, you can keep adding those in and we can access those networks remotely as well. Now, once you enable the settings here in the Tailscale plugin, you'll then need to go back to your Tailscale dashboard to actually enable the features fully. So let's do that now. So here you can see my services that are running. Here's our Unraid server, Osiris. And if we just click the three dots beside it and go to edit route settings, when you first set it up, it will not have this tick here. It will actually ask you to confirm. This is obviously for security. So if somebody messes with your server trying to advertise routes, they would also need to confirm it here in your Tailscale dashboard. So we can see that the IP address has come through and typically it'll show like this. One route is advertised but not approved. So you'll tick it and say, yep, I want to be able to use that. And you'll also have the exit node option here as well. Usually unticked, go ahead and tick that too and click save. That allows us to have the subnets and the exit node. Now, one thing you might want to consider, depending on your needs, is disabling the key expiry. So as you can see here, expiry is disabled. So if I go to the three dots again, enable key expiry. At some point, as you can see 30 minutes from now, that Tailscale authentication will drop off, meaning the plugin will need to be re-authenticated. If you're using a headless setup, a server where you've got Tailscale running, it's probably not in your best interest to have to re-authenticate all the time. But if you're more security conscious and you would rather just do that whenever you need it, by all means, enable the key expiry. But for me, I find disabling the key expiry is just more user-friendly and, you know, makes me happier. Now, what we can do and what you might find is that the DNS name that's pulled in Tailscale might be wrong. So what we can do is actually edit that. Now, as you can see, by default, it pulls it from the operating system's host name. We can actually change that to anything we want. In this case, I've just called it Osiris. Now, when we do that, it means I can use the magic DNS feature of Tailscale to refer to it by its host name that we set. So I can basically jump onto any network as long as I'm connected to Tailscale and just go to Osiris and it will send me to that device. The alternative is the IP addresses. Let's say you didn't want to enable the local IPs or subnets from your server. That's perfectly fine. You don't have to do that either. You can actually use the IP addresses that Tailscale gives you. So if I grab this IP address here, for example, and we type it into our browser and hit enter, you'll notice that it takes me directly to my Unraid server on that IP address. Alternatively, we can also use the DNS name. So like I said earlier, we've got our DNS name here and a bunch of other ones, including IPv6, if we have that enabled. If we did have those ACL tags in order to lock down access, this is where we can do it as well. So we can create tags and assign them to different resources so that we can say, you know, myself, I can access this server, but I can't access, you know, this one here up in the cloud. Useful when you're using a team setup or you just want to be able to share access with your family via Tailscale without opening up to the internet. Now, remember guys, we haven't opened up any ports to make this happen. We haven't had to touch our router. Everything is just being automatically done for us via the Tailscale network. Now, up in the top here, we can go to DNS. Now, this is another handy little thing that you can do. What we can do is actually set custom DNS settings in Tailscale so that devices connected via Tailscale can use those DNS settings to transfer through. So, for example, I've got NextDNS here in mine. You might want to add your own, say Google or Cloudflare DNS, whatever the case might be, and have them set up here so that when devices go through, we override them. Now, currently I haven't got that override setting on. You can see that, which means it's going to use the local DNS settings of that device, whatever you've set there. And now in Magic DNS, this is where you can either enable or disable that feature to be able to use DNS across your network rather than IP addresses. So as it says here, automatically register domain names for devices in your tailnet. It lets you use a machine's name instead of its IP address. If you're not interested in that feature, you don't want to use that, go ahead and just disable it. Now, the dashboard gives us a lot of really handy things. We can look at logs, see what's happening with our servers, whether there's anything we need to be concerned about. We can also go under services and see exactly what services are being allowed through the Tailscale network, and we can see what the IP and ports are for them. All right, so you can see those here as well. Then we have apps. So we can route traffic to third-party SaaS apps through connectors on our Tailnet. And then while you're in the dashboard, take some time to go through the actual settings tab in Tailscale. Okay, this is gonna give you a whole bunch of different options that you might want to just review and make sure you understand so that you understand what's happening. We go under user management, we can provide that, how users log in. So currently I've got GitHub as the option, whether we want users to be approved, you know, before they can be added, probably a good idea. I might even just tick that on now while we're here. Device management, we want approval before they can access the network. The defaults for key expiry are here as well. And whether we want auto update to take place on our machines. So now what about the client side? So we've got our server set up, we have our routing set up, everything's looking good. What about client devices? So here I am on my desktop. I've installed the Tailscale, you know, installation here on Windows. When you right click for the first time, it's going to ask you to sign in. So obviously go through that process and sign in. And now if I right click that option, you'll see here under exit nodes, I can select any of the exit nodes that I've enabled. So I can go through my server in Germany if I want, or I can go through my server here at home. Do I want to allow local network access? So I'm doing this from the device's point of view, my client device point of view, rather than the server. Do I want to run my device, my client device, as an exit node instead? So it gives you some options on your actual client device as well. Under preferences, some useful things you might want to know about. Do we want to allow incoming connections using the Tailscale DNS settings? Yes. Using Tailscale subnets to automatically install updates, which I recommend. And do we want to run unattended? Now, this is my desktop. It's no need for it to be unattended because when I'm done working on it, I'll shut it down. But if you're running this on a VM or something like that, and you want to be able to have constant access, you might want to consider running unattended on there. Now, another handy thing we can do is actually go under network devices, highlight devices, and you'll see other devices on the Tailscale network that are currently online. So what I can do is select OSIRIS, and it will copy the IP address for that device, and then I can just go into my browser, and it'll take me straight there. Now, here's why Tailscale is a game changer for security. All traffic is encrypted end-to-end with WireGuard. You don't need to open any ports at all on your router or firewall. Your services stay hidden from the internet. Access is tied to your identity. So if you use something like Google Sign In or GitHub, whatever other option you pick, people will have to access that account first in order to actually get into your Tailscale network. And if you want extra peace of mind, which I always recommend, enforce things like two-factor authentication on the accounts you're using to authenticate to Tailscale. No more exposed SSH, no more ports 3389 for your RDP sitting completely open to the internet. Now, once you're comfortable, Tailscale has some extra useful features you might want to explore. Tailscale Funnel. This lets you share a service publicly through Tailscale without exposing your network. Exit nodes, which we've covered as well. You can route your internet traffic through your home network or use one device as a secure gateway. Access control lists, great for bigger setups where you want to restrict access to certain resources or people. But don't worry, for most people, just installing it and signing in is enough to make your life way easier. So let's recap. Stop opening ports, forget the hassle of dynamic DNS, use Tailscale to access your service remotely, securely, and without all the stress. If you're brand new to home lab or self-hosting, this is hands down one of the best tools you can implement for your setup. If you found this helpful, drop a comment below. Are you still using port forwards, or have you already jumped ship to something like Tailscale? Let us know. If you want us to dive into advanced features like exit nodes, ACLs, or Tailscale SSH, let me know and we'll take a look in the next video. As always, thank you for watching and don't forget to subscribe so we don't miss you in the next one. I appreciate having you here. We'll see you in the next IBRACORP video.